Hey guys, Quiff the Lazy Geek here, and welcome back to another episode of Starting Astrophotography for Lazy People. So last time we talked about the telescope, we talked about the camera, but I didn't go into details about monochrome camera versus color camera, also known as OSC, for one-shot color camera. First things first, I want to add something to my last video. I'm filming this before it was released, but I'm sure there might have been some kind of flame war about like the best telescope. Obviously, the best telescope is whatever you want to get. The only thing that I'm offering is advice on how to be lazy about, like, in the end, your setup. That's why I recommend telescopes that will not require a lot of fiddling around. And, you know, if for you a Schmidt-Cassegrain doesn't require a lot of fiddling around, or a Newt doesn't require a lot of fiddling around, or a RASA doesn't require a lot of fiddling around, then, you know, go for it. But most of the time we'll be looking at refractors, or a Newt like this one, which does not require a recollimation by the end user. But again, you are free to choose whatever telescope you want. I'm just giving my personal opinion on the matter about, you know, how I go about being lazy with regards to astrophotography. So with that out of the way, let's talk about the camera. So the cameras, we've looked at the field of view, the resolution, everything like that. So I think we're all good on that front. Where we are still remaining to see, and this is very interesting because I have a setup here with a monochrome camera here, a color camera there, is, you know, should I go monochrome or color? So let's think about it. What is the difference? So first, all color sensors from cameras, they are at their heart a monochrome sensor. And on top of each pixel, we put a little cute tiny filter and a little cute tiny, what we call a micro lens. It's a little tiny lens the size of a pixel. It's super cute. But the principle being that each pixel will be specializing in detecting a certain color. So one pixel will be red, the next one will be green, the next one will be green again, and the last one will be blue. And then you repeat that pattern, that square, all across the sensor. And once you're done, you'll be saying like, okay, we have red, green, green, blue, red, green, green, blue, red, green, green, blue. And we'll do an extrapolation based on neighboring pixels. For each pixel, we'll determine what final color it probably was. And like you might be thinking like, wait, so each pixel is to a specific color, but we end up with each pixel having like a mixture of red, green, and blue. So don't we lose in terms of precision there? Yes, yes we do. So first, the filters, they take out a lot of the light. Two, the filters, most of the time you have twice as many green filters, green pixels, as you have red or blue pixels. The reason being that we as humans, our eye is more sensitive to green than it is to blue or to red. So we try to replicate that in our one-shot color sensors. The problem being as well that in deep space astrophotography, unless you're photographing comets, there's not a lot of green out there to grab. I mean, some nebulae, the O3 frequency is blue-green, but still, green is a color that you don't typically see, pure green, in astrophotography. So that means that in this color camera, maybe half of the pixels are wasted at all times because they're green. It's not really the case, but that's something to keep in mind. And so you have this, each pixel having a little filter on top. That filter cuts off some light that's reaching your sensor, and it's also restricting yourself to a specific color for that sensor. And then we have a process that will approximate the mix of red, green, and blue colors for that particular pixel. That process is called the Debayering process. The red, green, and blue filters that you have on top of all of the filters, of all of the pixels, when you look at it from the sensor point of view, you call it a Bayer matrix. That's where the Debayering operation comes from. And that Debayering operation, it can be very efficient. You have very good algorithms to do that operation, but you'll still be losing some resolution when you're doing that. So an OSC sensor will have less resolution in the end than a monochrome sensor of the same pixel size. And that's one thing to keep in mind. So, you know, when we're saying that, you know, for we want to have a resolution that's twice as good as the smallest detail size that you want to get, which is what I mentioned in the previous video in this series. Well, for an OST sensor, I mean, it's even true for a monochrome sensor, you would actually want a little bit more than twice as good, maybe three times as good. This is doubly true for a color camera, because a color camera will actually lose some resolution due to the way that the Bayer matrix works. So what the color camera has going for it, though, is that it is one-shot color. You get all the color signal with a single exposure. Whereas for monochrome cameras, how do you get color data? Well, you use filters. You see, I have a filter wheel here that contains what we call luminance, and then which is basically transparent. It's just filtering out some frequencies we never need. And I have red, green, and blue filters in there. And so I'll be taking exposures in luminance, in red, in green, in blue. And then in the end, I'll be stacking all of this together to get a color picture. You know, but that means that each time when I use the red filter, all of the pixels of my camera are used to capture the red signal. When I use the blue filter, all of the pixels in the camera are used to capture the blue color. When I use the green filter, all of the pixels are used to capture the green color. And then we're going to stack that together. So obviously you can tell that it is more precise. We're getting all of the pixels participating for each of the colors, whereas in this one some pixels are red, 1/4 of the pixels are red, 1/4 of the pixels are blue, and 1/2 of the pixels are green. So you can tell something, you're losing a lot with a color camera, but still the color camera will have one shot getting everything. That's really powerful. Whereas with a monochrome camera and those luminance red, green, and blue filters, well, you could be imaging your target, a galaxy, for example, and then like you've managed to get luminance red, green, and then clouds roll in and you didn't get the blue. Tough luck. So there are things that you can do to avoid that. You can, you know, have an autofocuser, which you will want to have to be lazy, as I have mentioned. And then with your filter wheel, you can determine what is called filter offsets, which means that when you go from one filter to the other, your focus point changes a little bit. And so you want to use your autofocuser to adapt to that. And if you can do it automatically, instead of doing like 100 exposures of luminance, 100 of red, 100 of green, 100 of blue, one after another, you could be doing luminance, one exposure, green, red, one exposure, green, one exposure, blue, one exposure, back to luminance, one exposure. And each time the focus would be adapted automatically, very quickly. So that's a workaround you can have for monochrome cameras with luminance, red, green, and blue filters. And in terms of exposure time, to get the same signal to noise ratio between your two cameras, if they were using exactly the same lens otherwise, you will need more exposure time with the color camera than you will need with the monochrome camera with LRGB filters. So, and we all know that our signal to noise ratio is what we are about. We want to minimize noise while maximizing signal that we capture. And so that's a very powerful thing about monochrome sensors, but you need to get filters with them. You need to get multiple filters. You need to get a filter wheel. You need to set up filter offsets, ideally. You want to do more processing in the end because you'll need to map your luminance red, green, and blue channels to proper colors and then do some color calibration. And there's a bit more that's involved in the stacking process as well. There's a bit more that's involved. So there's a bit more work in terms of post-processing, but you maximize your signal-to-noise ratio and you maximize your resolution compared to one-shot color camera. The one-shot color camera, why it's very attractive and why I have one here, is that it's one-shot color. You get one picture, you have the color signal, and you can take many pictures, stack them together, and then you'll have a color picture from the get-go. There's no, you know, no pre-processing specific to aligning the color channels and all that kind of stuff. Not that the processing for the monochrome cameras is very complex or anything, it's just that, you know, the color camera will do everything at once. So there's a convenience, a laziness, if you will, that's attached to it. But strictly speaking, the monochrome camera with the LRGB filter is superior. It's just that the color camera is more convenient. That's why I have both, and that's why for my Galaxy season, last season, I used the color camera rather than the, in theory, superior monochrome plus LRGB filters. Although I think that for the next Galaxy season, I'll use the monochrome plus LRGB filters. You know, so I'll be able to compare how well it works. Another advantage of monochrome is that you can use what is called narrowband filters. And I have a video about that if you want to look at it. I'm linking it to it right now. And narrowband filters are used to capture signal, specific signal that comes from nebulae, emission nebulae, like lots of nebulae in the Milky Way, the Rosette Nebula, the Cygnus Wall Nebula, North American Nebula, the California Nebula, the Veil Nebula, all these nebulas, and you can use those filters that will basically reject a lot of the light pollution, and you can actually do incredible narrowband imaging from within the city, within Tokyo, within Singapore, within London, and get excellent results because you're rejecting a lot of the camera to focus only on those nebula specific colors or wavelength. So that's another advantage of the monochrome sensor. But you can, those filters, those narrowband filters, they're not cheap. So you can tell that with a monochrome sensor, you will need more stuff. You'll need a filter wheel. You'll need filters that go with it. You'll need more processing in the end. So there is more know-how linked to monochrome sensors. But monochrome sensors, they're more versatile. And they're more precise. They have better resolution than an identical color sensor. And they gather more signal to noise ratio in the same amount of time as a color sensor. So in all respects, they are superior, but the setup with the filter wheel and the focus offsets and the processing is more painful to do. Although in the end, you can automate all of that just as well as a color sensor. So strictly speaking, I would have to recommend going for a monochrome camera and get all of the additional equipment that's linked to that, because everything can be automated. But I still have a soft spot for color sensors, and I like color sensors for their convenience. So I cannot fully recommend monochrome either. But again, strictly speaking, monochrome is superior, and you'll see that monochrome cameras for the same sensor are typically more expensive, and that's because they are, strictly speaking, better at gathering signal to noise, at gathering resolution than color sensors are. It's all in the end a matter of personal choice. If I were to start from scratch, I think I would go for a monochrome sensor, because I would have a very good way to know what to do next after I've bought my sensor, my monochrome camera, because of this excellent series of videos about starting astrophotography for beginners. Okay, so with that, I think I've covered everything about monochrome sensors versus OSC one-shot color or color sensors with the Bayer matrix on top. Summary is, if I were to start from scratch again, I would go for a monochrome sensor with filters. In the end, it's up to you. You can have very sexy looking equipment and very good results with color sensors. I mean, just look at what people are accomplishing with uncooled DSLRs. Although for us to be lazy again, you will want probably a cool astro camera. So the choice is yours. I've given my opinion. You do whatever you want from that, but now you have all of the tools to choose both your telescope and your camera. But before you do so, remember that the bigger your telescope is, the more your mount will need to be beefy to support it. So don't buy anything yet. We'll go in the next episode into the actual mount and how to choose your mount and what are the important parameters to look at. So thank you so much for watching this. Make sure that you will not miss the next episode by liking, subscribing, and clicking the notification bell icon. Also, never forget to look up at the stars whenever they're visible, and I'll see you next time.